back to King's County to say, what should, I did psychology in the Army testing, but was achievement testing in the Signal Corps. And no one could go out and get shot until I said they weren't qualified. The testing consisted of, for the cooks and bakers, when you're making shepherd's pie, how many shepherds do you put in? One more never left, by the way, if you don't know. I came back to King's County and I said, well, I want to go to graduate school, where should I go? I said, what are you thinking of? He said, well, I want to go to Yale. Why? I said, I always wanted to sweat with it. Why?
Read the sense of the sheet.
The reason you go to school. I applied to NYU and to Berkeley because they were, one was near and one was far. And I was accepted to both. So where are you going to go? He said, you have to go to KU. So where? KU. What's there? He said, there is the Menninger Foundation. And why there? They took out two red volumes, the ones that Roy wrote to. That's why. You have to study the day without no place to go. But I saw Macover and his wife were the best I knew at that time. Karen was crazy with a draw man test, but otherwise they played tennis well. And they seemed to know what they were talking about. And my job was to pick up Rorschach cards when they were dropped. That was the system I did. And we did a little work now. No, that was not so many. When Rorschach cards were scarce, Bob Trollman had hired us to use a gun release to clean off the Rorschach cards and tell where the blots were and what the dirt was. But when I went out to Philadelphia, I met Bill for the first time. And of course, S, H coming before S, he got the queen of the crop. He was tested by the book I did around for. I had mine by Roy Schaefer. I don't remember this, but he gave the test, and of course, no, there was, you scored as he went along with proper work. You don't wait till the end. I didn't look up to the stat. I remember saying, well, that's not an F minus. And it wasn't. I didn't have to see David Rappaport until the end of the day, by which time he was very tired. He looked at me and said, would you mind if we went back to you? I won't enter the act to my hotel room. I'm very, very tired. I was all signed up to NYU. I was there to please my mentors at King's County Hospitals. I didn't much know what to get. So I went back to his room. Do you mind if I stop for a minute? I didn't get home. So I stopped on the way. We got him along to way back to his room. Mind if I took my suit jacket off? It's very hot here in Philadelphia. He says, now, well, so why do you want to come to PU? I said, I don't. He says, why? I said, well, I'm not really that interested in clinical things. Well, so I'm interested in research. And I guess the kind of research I'm interested in. And he said, but that, I didn't realize it wasn't a turn off, but it turned on. So after, I don't remember much after that. But clearly, I was accepted and went out there. Where of course I met, found George Klein, a recidivist, this word from Menninger, from Brooklyn College, both interested in the same thing. And Phil and I and Bob and George formed a threesome to get into the psychology of perception and cognition, cognitive styles, and all that lot of good stuff. And I think we ran the paradigm by, as a matter of fact, until part of it and picked up.
Like, louder, please.
Yeah. But anyway, you might be interested to know how Rappaport got to Menninger. Because Roy mentioned he was Osawatomi. What's a Hungarian Jew from the U.S. doing in Osawatomi, Kansas? I think because he was a refugee from the European horrors. I think Bethlehem was a friend who got him located out there and mentioned him to Carl Menninger. Carl Menninger asked J.F. Brown, you know the same memory? Was a Marxist psychoanalyst, social psychologist at KU at the time. And what about this guy? So J.F. Brown was doing the testing somehow for Menninger at that time, way back when. And he said, well, take a look at him. So Menninger took a look at him and says, David Rappaport, please come up here, give me a Rorschach. That's the test for him. And he had to test him and write him a report.
Would you?
They were very careless with the files.
Well, they had the guidelines.
I don't know that, so I preserved it.
What was the diagnosis?
This is a HIPAA matter.
Anyway, as it all turned out very well, as you can see, the rest of it. So they were brought to the clinic, and of course, he turned it inside out. It was never the same after that. What you might not have caught from the way the testing was done was Rappaport was a devotee of blind testing, which means that one person would do a test, someone would do another test, and the person who wrote the report may not have seen the patient. In fact, that was the ideal situation. We're looking at testing. And so when the case conference was run, it was like a CPC in a hospital. Pathologists had the last word. The clinical psychologist had the last word, as if you were with a psychological course. I think the main lesson, in addition to everything Gabriel said, is that the idea of process was the key idea that came across from David Rappaport. Whatever else it was, in fact, I remember the lesson was process. Roy wrote up very impressively later on how the story came about. The idea was, how did this response come about? That was the question we all asked the same time. Right or wrong didn't matter. The patient is marching to a different drummer. A wrong response is a gem. How did that wrong response come about? Why was it right that the patient gave that response? And there, I think therein lies the way the psychology in that capturing that model.
Don't forget the structure. That was very important for me.
Structure is only a slowly moving drummer. Structure was the process of forgotten to get on with it. But the idea of structure, of course, was I've struggled with over the years as well. And I recall once Charlie Brenner asked me, how come it was that you, all the students at David Rappaport, you're the only one who didn't turn against medical psychology. I said, because I know it's really serious in the present.
This is wonderful stuff.
Robert Hurd, it was an intellectual discipline.
Oh, yeah. You know,
that was the crucial thing, the process of this. It was like looking at the Talmud. You're not going to take the Talmud seriously.
Yeah, it was, and of course it stayed over with me. And I was asked later to teach psychoanalytic theory in the Institute, and I said, I can't teach psychoanalytic theory. There is no such thing. It's a loose federation of small package theories. There is no such thing as I can teach Freud's theorizing, if you like a course on that. Why he came to this point, when he came to this point, what was the problem he was trying to solve? And why this is the best answer you can know at the time. That course I'll teach, but not theory. And it was interesting. They allowed me to teach that course and the students rebelled. What they wanted was theory, not theory.
Can I tell a quick joke, which is a true story, apropos of what Herb just said? Carl Nenni got an honorary degree at Harvard University. And when he came for it, he wanted to see Harry Murray. We haven't seen each other in a long time. So I arranged a visit at Murray's house. And they come in and they greet each other like one-on-one friends. Hello, Harry. Hello, Carl. I haven't seen you since the 1930s. Yes, that's right. Says, when you used to come to New York and argue with Karen Horney. Carl Medica says, I never argued with Karen Horney. Of course, he used to publish these things that were anti-Horney. And Murray says, of course, you used to argue with her all the time. And Carl stops. He says, oh, he says, in those days, we used to argue about everything. We would argue about theories. We would argue about when this analyst treated a man who had a problem with his mother-in-law. He would write a paper, not about this man's mother-in-law, but about all the mothers-in-law in history.
Absolutely true.
From one case.
Sample one.
Only Rappaport. Rappaport also opened our eyes to the whole world of Western literature. We learned methodology, theory, thinking about theory, epistemology.
Okay.
Philosophy of science, and they knew, of course, there was a madman called Raymond Wheeler. But when the people organizing psychology, psychology of the time, he actually went crazy after a while, because we did some city college, Brooklyn College, in his classroom. He started to talk and be challenged quite a lot. He put his head down on the desk, you know, but he went, But he introduced us to Darcy Thompson, theoretical biology, organism theory. So in a sense, kind of the whole thing joined us to an education that college never did. And what I got used to, we had to, of course, some of the chapter retreats and everything else. We got used to, there was nothing new to learn, actually. Nothing worthwhile, you know, used to, except in very curious situations. So my first supervisor said to me, you're going to be very nervous before your first year. Take it in, you talk, because you're going to be very nervous when you see it.
Although I've heard stories, so I kind of, and I've been looking forward to this panel to come hear about David Rappaport, the people who knew him quite well. I got an inkling of it, because when I arrived in July, my degree was not awarded until September. I told Phil this story before, and he was a bit put off by that, so he referred to me from July through September as my dear Mr. Dr. Schwartz. And I became Dr. Schwartz in September when the degree was given me. A few disconnected thoughts that I just would like to share with you. One has to do with the virus. I know I've been listening and hearing a lot of what people have been describing, but no one has mentioned this. It was contagious, and it was airborne, and you got it by sitting and talking to Dr. Rappaport. And the symptoms of the virus was that you had to collect data, you had to write, and you definitely had to publish. And all the people around him seemed to be infected with this virus. I mean, it was very, very striking. I published when I was dyslexic. And, you know, you had no choice. Totally different story. He once asked me if I knew why he knew Freud better than anyone else in the world. And I said, no, I don't know why. And he said, because I've read it more times than anyone else in the world, which was, I think, probably true, yes. Someone had mentioned his preparing the Freud every year when he was teaching. He would go over it and re-prepare it and with it, yes. Yes, there's a... But it was prepared in a particular way. It was not like you read the New York Times. He would study it, he would underline, he would take notes. There's a line in chapter 7 of The Interpretation of Dreams, I can even tell you the page, which is Rappaport's influence, where Freud is talking about what happens to an idea when attention is withdrawn from it.
And page 623.
Actually, it's 538. There's this room with a transition. It's the standard edition. There's this throwaway line where Freud says, "An attention, as it seems, is available in a limited amount," and it's totally irrelevant to the topic. And then he goes on to talk about something else. Limited amount. Rappaport focused on limited amount. As the limit concept, and that was the basis of his theory of attention kinesis. I mean, this sounds like word magic. But you have to understand, Freud was God, Rappaport was Moses, bringing the tablets down. And, you know, this is what you did. Let's see. Yeah, two stories. One is a story that Rappaport told me, and I don't know whether anyone else here knows it. It's about the golem and the little boy. Did anyone hear that? You heard it, Peter? Okay. Little boy comes running into where his father is seated and says, "Father, father, I just saw a golem in the fireplace." And the father, upon hearing this, gives his son a box on the ear, which is a nice way of saying a smack across the side of the head. And the boy cries out in pain and says, "Father, father, why did you do that?" And the father, smiling, says, "So you will never forget what you saw this day." Now, one question is why Rappaport told me this story. I took it as a warning. But he taught that way. He had that kind of a style, and it would include a box on the ears at times. The other story is, I think, one that people know, but I just want to repeat it. It's just the gist of it. It's the story of Moses in the 1951 paper on the autonomy of the ego. And to me, that story always had an autobiographical cast to it. The gist is that the king hears many positive things about Moses. He arranges to have his portrait painted. He shows the portrait to his wise men, and they describe Moses as greedy, cruel, and self-serving. So you have oral, anal, and phallic. And the king arranges to meet with Moses, finds him to be kind and generous and caring, all the things we learned about last night. And finally, at the end of the meeting, the king tells Moses about what the wise men had said. And Moses says, "Well, that's correct." And by way of explanation adds, "That's what I had to overcome to be the way I am today, or to be who I am today." Now, I wanted Peter to follow me because I can just see him saying to himself, "Well, that's what we all had to overcome. What's the big deal?" But I think Rappaport had to overcome more of that than the rest of us. I think that was part of his impact on people that he worked with and taught. So, thank you.
Thank you very much. The thing that occurred to me while everybody was talking was that, in a sense, D.R. was the master of metapsychology, and all of his students turned their back, if you will, on it. And I think a snotty psychoanalytic interpretation would be the son's turning on the father. I think that's incorrect. It seemed to me that he reached a logical conclusion. He took metapsychology as far as it could go, like Mondrian painted his squares to the extent. And beyond that, there was nothing to do with it. And that the other aspect of this that strikes me is that although he was an autocrat about teaching seventh chapter, I had several occasions to note that when somebody showed him that he was wrong, like Jean Chimek, he was delighted because somebody had shown him that even he could be wrong. And he took this with great jealousy. And I think one should not overestimate the autocracy, because there is another side to this. The other point, I think that Phil and I, when we tried to run these shows, kept in mind was that David Rappaport had an enormous scope of broad interest. And it wasn't just psychoanalysis, it wasn't just all this. I had the privilege of running the Friday evening seminars under his tutelage, and he would just bring anybody that seemed to have something interesting to say or to do including the woman who constructed the rocking chair for John F. Kennedy, the Batman that, I forgot his name, that followed bats for their echolocation, he brought them here, etc. And I think it is a pity that this...
Don Griffin.
This has disappeared. And I think this is a great pity, which we tried to do to preserve and et cetera. Okay. Among, I think the biggest fiasco of that was Peter Schiller, who was one of his dear students. And he became a neurophysiologist, and people were scratching something in their body when he was talking.
Did some extraordinarily important work. Peter Schiller discovered that purpose, you know, one of the purposes of the certain part of the brain is to regulate saccadic ion.
Yeah. Waves. And it came over like a lead balloon one day. And that's the pity of it. Now, on a more personal note, I get, again, I think that the generosity of this man cannot be really told in full. For 2 years while I was here a fellow, he discovered that I was interested in Piaget, and he spent 2 years, 2 hours, 3 hours a week, we went over not the seventh chapter, but the origins of intelligence precisely in the same way. And he would extract a passage, I would extract a passage, we would say which one was contradictory, etc. And it was an education in its own right, those hours. When I then became a career scientist, or I got one, obviously with his help, he became one of the sponsors. And he would insist once a month, 4:30 in the afternoon, I had to come in from Boston. We would spend that day, Saturday and Sunday afternoon, until Sunday afternoon, about the studies I was doing on babies. I would write some things to him. He would comment, and the comments are much, much more interesting than the original content. It was also much longer. If I came late, he got annoyed. And this was day and a half, 2 days, that he devoted just to this project, which was nothing to do with psychoanalysis, but it was of interest to him, so he did it. I think this kind of...
But it was also loyalty to you.
Well, sure. I mean, he had taken me on as a student, and this is the other part of it. I think some people felt overwhelmed or incorporated by DR when he took on somebody. I think it was scary to people because you tended to feel wiped out by this presence. But what he was really after is for you to get out from under, eventually to become independent, like the story in Kafka, The Trial. I don't know, the sub-story where the guy sits in front of the door all the time until he discovers all he has to do is go through the door. And I think this was the point, that at least that's my image of what he was trying to do, is get people to come free of him. Now, obviously, it was males and sons that were very important to him. But I think he didn't want to own people. He wanted them to break free from you. At least that's my impression. 6 months before he died, he talked to me once and said, "You know, Dr. Wolf, I think it is time in about 6 months or in a year to call each other by our first names." And then he died.
Just add a word. In terms of the breadth of his interest, I think there hasn't been enough emphasis on an aspect that I think you might must know about Peter. He was a left-wing Zionist, and he didn't come directly from the Holocaust theory. He'd been in Israel for years, where, among other things, one of his jobs on the kibbutz was dispensing condoms. I think, I don't know the full subjective experience, but I think he must have decided that he was underemployed. And that was the period that preceded his coming to the United States. But all the time that I knew him, he maintained a very active worldwide correspondence with many people. He helped refugees, he maintained an interest in the Jewish cause and problems in Europe. And so many, many people other than his students owe him a tremendous amount. And one thing that enabled him to do it, besides all the sterling character qualities, is that he slept very little at night, which supports my general theory. People who get the most don't sleep more than 4 hours a night.
I want to add one thing. Peter's generous suggestion was that there are two people who should be here who aren't. One, Margaret, who's not feeling well, of course, knew Rappaport very, very well. And also S. White, who was unable to attend but wrote this brief note. I just want to mention that. I think the issue of a Riggs presence is important, said S. Too often nowadays, it seems to me that the DR of his eponymous study group must have gone directly from Menninger's to his year at NYU. We gave him his clinical presence here and benefited greatly from his very informative bull sessions for fellows, at which no topic was barred and none found to be outside his area of expertise. Now, Erickson thought, if I know this story correctly, that it might be a good idea for Rappaport to have some experience as a therapist, four-time-a-week analytic therapist with one of these patients. I don't know if he tried it, but it was a good idea. He was excellent as in this other capacity. Every patient here at Riggs had not only a therapist, but a counselor. Now, the counselor is somebody who took care of the whole life with the person, not just the internal life. And he was a superb counselor, a bully, who helped people enormously in their day-to-day. He would be called today a coach.
Personal trainer.
I think, however, I had to take over, substitute for a while when I take
over.
And precisely because all of the Sterling characters that came in, he was a terrible therapist.
I think he enlisted with Erickson because of what he subsequently wrote, which was that he was going to try to find a way to link Erickson, Freud, and Hartman so that he would be not
his idea to bring in the concept of
Jeff Bauman. Of course. So I raised my hand. I said, I think I know what it's really doing. And he said, what? I said, Copley's Law. You haven't heard of Copley's Law? I wouldn't have heard of if I hadn't been a fellow. And Rappaport looked up, and he seemed momentarily impressed, but certainly hadn't passed the test yet. He said, Dr. Eagle, could you tell us what Copley's Law is? And I, for a moment, thought, oh, I really screwed myself. I said I knew, but certainly without not with precision. And sure enough, it all came back. And I said something like, the greater the perception span in an ensemble, the less attention to any element in the field. And conversely, the greater the attention to any single element, the short of the perception span. That was it. From that point on, I was his pet. And then he actually asked me to come work with him at Riggs. That's the year. And I was just getting married to Carol Eagle. And I said, I'm just getting married, and I think I need to have a year here, but I would seriously consider a year after, thank God. But, so for that,
there was money collected for an institute here, and I was to be part of that. I was to leave for a year and then come back and submit an institute to develop a learning theory for psychoanalysis. So you would be
part of that. But that wonderful marriage of the City College tradition suddenly interacting with the Rappaport experience, and of course, as you might imagine, it was a peak experience for me to have him present and satisfy Rappaport. So that's my Rappaport story.
You just mentioned the halo effect. This is true. Any number of people have a right answer on earlier.
Questions? Let's open it up.
Yeah, I would love to hear the panelists just speculate about this issue of speculation. But given his focus at the time on metapsychology and on a particular viewpoint, and given the way the field has moved in the last 40 years, including the change, many of the changes that were initiated by people who are part of this group. Had he lived a very long life, but given his intellectual style, his proclivities, and so on, what are your thoughts as to how he would have how he would have responded to the developments in
psychoanalysis?
Well, now there's the thing that it should be remembered that this man has died at 49.
Unbelievable. You're also terrible.
Can we do it?
Every time it would happen to us, he said, please, I don't have long to live.
He had a rheumatic cough.
Yeah.
And you know, the interesting thing, Roy, about that, and people, that Elvira, his wife, refuses to this day to admit that he had a rheumatic heart. He was a paragon of everything, including health.
How should we approach your planning?
He died, what is it, 1960? 75, before the church, before the double helix, before the revolution in neurobiology. I think if you look to this day, you would have some way of thinking about the many times that you're probably wrong about the fact. Real blind eye. But I think it would come alive for them now that there's new ways of thinking about what goes on in the nervous system. And I think that I would love to see his way to try to put together neurobiology and psychology.
I think that Peter said that he had mined all of the ore in metapsychology, and he was beginning to move in an empirical direction with Fred and Richard, published that monograph on attention deficits. He was moving in that direction towards a kind of empirical thrust, and I think that he, in a sense, had finished with a top-down analysis and wanted to get information, empirical information, to build from the bottom up. And I think he would have gone on to be really part of the cognitive revolution that was just starting at the time he died. Because there was a mushrooming of so many things, like Posner's work, Kozanich's work, a whole bunch of things were just starting at the time he died. He would have been in the middle of that.
He never did experiments.
He never did experiments.
He started. And that's what Fred and Richard Grouse picked up, which we just started
signing.
But it wouldn't be neuropsychoanalysis.
No, it wouldn't.
He was more helpless. As early as the time when I was still a young student of his, he was following the work of a man named Ward Olmsted, I think, in Chicago.
Dr. Carver, I don't know if he was a psychologist.
He was a psychologist.
He was a neuropsychologist.
But he was a real pioneer of neuropsychology, and Rappaport was a word in for that.
Yes.
See, I was with him once, on one of the visits when there was a meeting in Chicago.
I wanted to say a word about the business of the students turning against metapsychology after he died. I think that's a somewhat of a misunderstanding, because already when he was writing The Structure of Psychoanalytic Theory, I was voicing doubts about psychic energy and trying to get him to explain what was the relation between psychic energy and physical energy, and he put in a footnote and about it there, which temporarily satisfied me, but the more I thought about it, the more I felt that that there were real problems. And one of the last times I was here at Riggs, before he died, I talked to him further about the thinking I've been doing about that, and he encouraged me to go ahead with it. He said he thought that was really a very necessary kind of thing. And my sense about that is that what I was doing and what others were doing was really in his spirit. I mean, it was the kind of work that he had taught us, that you don't take anything for granted. You try to look at the underlying assumptions. You try to relate what's going on to what's happening in other sciences. And he was perfect. He wasn't, I think, rigid in his devotion to metapsychology. He took it, as you said, as far as he could go, and clarified it to the point where it was increasingly easy to see its deficiencies.
You know, I don't know whether you remember when Galli from Bologna was here. Made it like that. This is precisely what he talked about, David Rappaport, and his strength, namely his devotion to logical reasoning, regardless of the content, whatever the content might be. And that's what we all
read. John Muller?
Yeah, I just wanted to speak as director of training here at Riggs for a minute about the way we still do psychological testing. We still apportion the test to three testers, one of whom is assigned to the report. The report supervises a two-hour weekly seminar, and the test report is still a vital functioning document in the twice-weekly case conference. So whatever mark he left in terms of that kind of approach remains. We're always accused of being old-fashioned about this. But that is the tradition that our four-year postdoctoral psychology fellows are still immersed in.
Good to be old-fashioned. It's good to be old-fashioned.
Well, my first 12 years at COVID, when COVID was just beginning, and was it had Sybil Escalona and Walter Cass, whom they imported from Langer, and the way you describe the way the case conferences went, it was the psychiatrist would present in great detail the clinical data, but then it was a psychology intern, like myself, who would then give the diagnosis. That was official. Whatever the psychologist reported was, in fact, accepted.
You had a lot of it.
Pardon?
You had a lot.
Yes, it was amazing. And the residents would come before him saying to me, please tell me what the diagnosis is. You know, we had no power as interns. In fact, there was a clear separation. We were clearly in the lowest possible seat. They wouldn't even let us do therapy if the division was very clear. Psychiatrists, residents did therapy. psychology intern only did testing, but nonetheless, in that clinical case seminar, it was psychology intern's red power.
And that's the New York State Psychiatric Institute also.
Is that yeah, good or Don not? Spence and Mauricio.
Given his interest in language, and especially in getting things right, getting right words and so on, I'm interested that he was never bothered by Freud translation.
No, oh, he was.
Was he?
He definitely was.
Did he make any efforts?
Yes.
Yes.
We studied it. It wasn't a standard edition. We worked from the Brill translations. He would pick up, this is wrong, and retranslated Brill.
And he would also correct the old straight sheet translation. John Ritter, yes. Was it Raglish?
It's wrong,
but translated it wrong.
This was never written in English. He never did a new translation.
No, but he did translate it in that thick volume. Organization of Pathology and Thought, he did translate the formulation concerning the two principles of many functions. His translation.
That's true, he did.
Yeah.
Yeah, well done.
Mauricio and Sid.
I was in Topeka from 71 to 76, so the question, what happened with this tradition? Well, when I was a resident, it was the same format. You know, the psychological diagnosis was the last word. And like before, we always try to get the scoop from the psychologist, hey, what's coming up? So that tradition continued in Topeka, although all this generation had left, it was still there when I was in Topeka.
Yeah, I want to speak for the people who were influenced by David Rappaport who never met him. I was a graduate student at Chicago in the late 50s, and I discovered a book, because I was interested in cognitive processes, called Organization of Pathology of Thought. And hearing you talk, many of you talk today,
don't worry.
It made me think of what it was like reading Organization Pathology of Thought. Chapter 28, the summary chapter in my volume of Organization Pathology of Thought, is completely underlined. Every line is underlined. And it's impressive how he had his impact on you, even though you never met him. And I used to think when I was a graduate student writing papers, I would think about merely these to David Rappaport and seeking his advice and his reaction to my paper. I never had the chutzpah to do it. I wish I had. When I got the Yale offer, frankly, I accepted the Yale offer for one major reason. It meant I could be at the Western New England. And I came there in July of 1960 with the hope of being at the Western New England and studying with David Rappaport. I got my acceptance in November, and David died in December. And for me, it was a major loss. Fortunately, I met Roy when I was there, and it was a major replacement. But I really came to New Haven to study with David Rappaport.
Did you come to Topeka also?
No, I applied for the postdoc. Raise a sensitive issue. You accepted me. I accepted your acceptance, and I withdrew my acceptance. And I never came.
Never gave you.
I know.
Erwin. I just wanted to share a little bit of my impressions of Nurt and Gill's feelings about David Rappaport that I got familiar with from my conversations with Burton over about 20 years. It was just an overall impression, which is consistent with the impression I have from all of you, which was that David was an enormous inspiration for Nurt. Gill, maybe one of the most important figures in his life, and continue to be that, you know, throughout. What was remarkable about it to me, but also to him, and I hear you all puzzling over it too and trying to make sense of it, was that he was that source of inspiration even after Merton's views departed so radically from his point of view from Rappaport's views, the actual content of what he was interested in, some of the actual ideas. I mean, he was repudiating many things that he attributed to Rappaport, despite the possibility of changes and so on toward the end and openness. There was still that element of a huge discrepancy between the actual content of what he felt he was taught by Rappaport and what he actually came to believe. And yet he thought of his own, sort of at another level, his own passion for the work and the
something about the kind of attitude he had toward the search for truth or for what's going on and so on, to be very much the legacy of his relationship with Rappaport. I think that's I don't know how common that is, but that to me it seems like, just listening to all of you and remembering the kinds of things Burton said, there's something remarkable about that comes across, about the just the way that this man could be such an inspiration that transcended issues of actual point of view or content of ideas and so on. Amazing, actually.
Chris Morrison.
Well,
it's something along those lines. Rappaport's been associated with systematization of metapsychology, and that's been done away with, and I've heard people say, oh gee, what a waste. But I've always thought a waste of devoting his life to metapsychology. But I think that would be mistaken, seriously mistaken. And the Rappaport tradition, which I think is presumably alive in this group, was, I always thought of Rappaport as devoted to bringing to bear on psychoanalytic theory findings, insights from neighboring disciplines.
And distant
disciplines. The Organization of Pathology of Thought is a wonderful example of that. It's the first place I read the reference to Clapton, which became an important case study in implicit memory research. Everyone who writes about implicit memory research refers to that Clapton article. Well, the first time I saw that article was Rappaport that identified it in the Organization of Pathology.
And his commentary
about it. So I think it's mistaken to associate or to limit Rappaport's contribution merely to the metapsychology and somewhat Talmudic systematization of psychoanalytic theory. There is a very rich and enduring tradition of psychoanalysis not being immune to the findings, in fact being enriched by the insights, findings, and integration with other disciplines. And I think that's a remarkable and enduring contribution.
But comments on that again. It wasn't that these other disciplines were subservient or subordinate to psychoanalysis.
No,
they were they interpenetrated each other.
Excellent.
Uh-huh.
That's
amazing.
Yeah, so I was thinking that I spent 25 years in Mongolia under the influence of Rappaport and the students called him.
Louder.
I spent 25 years at the Lemuel Foundation under the influence of Rappaport and Schlesinger and Holtzman and mainly those two students came to know very well. But when Otto Kernberg invited me to come to Cornell, I was just thrilled. I thought, now is my chance to build a little mini-group thing within the Westchester Hospital and to introduce those ideas that had become part of me. And so when I came there and found that everybody was pouncing on these new patients that we admitted, started treating them from the minute they got there, I said, no. I have a package of memos that's probably this fat, explaining why you should make a thorough study of the patient before you decide whether and how to treat it, or whether you even have the right person, and whether this is the patient or somebody else is the patient, all these ABCs that I had learned in Topeka. And I insisted that the psychologists test the patients, and they were supposed to find out what these patients were made of. To my surprise and dismay, the people that rebelled the most against this new regime were the psychologists. Because they wanted to interview the patients. They thought that interviewing the patients was a lot more fun than than the rationalization was. It was a lot more informative than doing the tests. So I had to work really hard to to get them to test the patients in a timely fashion and write a report that the psychiatrist could understand. And I think I failed ultimately to achieve any of this. I think that the trend was so powerful toward homogenization of tests and toward getting things done fast and the limitations out of the hospital that I never could have my own money with them.
Wasn't testing a low status?
Yes, yes, I was thinking it's politically complicated.
Right. Now, upstairs in the library, as part of Rappaport's library, there's a whole section of his books on mysticism and the occult. Anybody care? Anybody know anything about that interest? How was it used by him?
So he didn't have a big collection of books.
He had a few collections.
He said he wanted to later on work on that as a project. Also,
hoaxes.
Also, hoaxes.
Yes,
magic and sound.
Was a hoax or not? I don't know.
Could you move just a little bit there?
I would like to pick up on Paul's question. Say some things about my view of it, not in an incomplete way, but some aspects of the way things have changed. And what I think, from my understanding of Rappaport, would have been his response to it. I think, this ties in with what Ann says, I think the idea of what are the important questions to ask, and what are the important operations to follow, to get what is now considered relevant and important knowledge have significantly changed. So that, for instance, a strong case has been made for active interviewing that is already involving interpretation. It's a different conception of how you gather knowledge about a person or what is important to know about them. Now, that would have been a challenge to his view, which is in some quarters today called one person psychology. How would he deal with this new kind of really epistemological issue that's related to Kuhn's work and other people's work? And I think he would have tried to find a way to preserve what he regarded as most useful from the past. And here I disagree with her a little. I think process was very important to him, but so was structure. And I think if you view it as a process with a slow rate of change, there are stabilizing constant things. You could call it character, personality, organization, psychic structure, whatever, that are simply not dealt with in the terms of what is currently considered important to know. And that have been sort of left by the wayside in the way that Hume often described. And I think he would have tried to stay with it, but also to take account of what changed. And I think that would have been an invaluable job, because I think it still needs to be done. Too much about stability has been lost in the interest of the flux of getting right in there and finding things out that way.
Well, I'm glad you said that, because that was sort of what I had in mind when I interjected about structure. The other comment I wanted to make was that I think we may have gotten a somewhat false impression about blind testing. One of the things that, I think David's idea was that this is primarily a method of teaching testing. that if you want somebody to be able to really get something out of the test rather than read into it what you know from some other source, then you've got to restrain the other information that you have. But when we were in this very initial training seminar in testing, before the first test was presented, he would say, what do you know about this person? Well, we knew the sex, we knew the age, we knew the educational level. We had one or two other sort of basic bits of demographic knowledge. And he insisted that we generate hypotheses on the basis of that information. In other words, you have a sort of a working model of, well, what do you expect from a 21-year-old, well, we didn't see many 21-year-old veterans, but a, let's say, 45-year-old white male from rural Kansas. You're not going to expect him to be like yourself, an Easterner from Ivy League College or something like that, or City College. And he encouraged you to express that and to make sure that you have those things as hypotheses in your mind, and that you didn't read them in, but that you tested against what you got out of the test material.
I think that's the most important point. Because we had this exercise doing what Bob has just said, writing a test report based on age, sex, educational background, mm-hmm. and locale growing up. You come out a marvelous test report knowing no more than that. But the lesson was, when you do your testing, I want to see the differences between expectancy and findings.
Yeah.
What does the test report add to this knowledge? Not that this knowledge is wrong, what does it add? There's a kind of ruthless honesty in the man, together with his deceptiveness and that sort of study of hoaxes. And to add one more thing, I don't differ with Roy about his issue of structure. I think he based it, as he said, on process. His major interest was in time, which he never got around to as a part of the research to investigate. The experience of time passing, that was a big issue for him.
But Herb, the whole concept of cognitive style is an illustration of the sort of structural thing that he taught. I mean, it was a direct outgrowth from the notion of ego structure,
mm-hmm.
And the different types of ego structure for paranoids and obsessive compulsives and hysterics, and that was a model that George picked up and applied there, and which I myself must say I've found extremely useful ever since. You don't have to believe that. That structure leaves ego superabundant. And that's a wholly different notion.
I'm just trying to stress there's a dialectic, what endures and what can change.
Yeah.
What is stable of personality and what can change. In fact, you can still recognize your friends after their analysis. The issue of what changes in the analysis is part of this whole business. I'm talking about the dialectic between what is structural or relatively enduring and what is plastic and changes.
On the point, just a brief word, on the point about blind testing that Bob just made, at a meeting, I think of the American Psychological, it was a symposium, a panel, the case of Gregor, with different people who knew a lot about testing participating, who were subsequently published in the Journal of Projective Techniques. Bob wrote a marvelous TAT analysis of this patient, Gregor, an anonymous patient. And the audience was wowed by it. And then Bob said, this is what I wrote before I wrote he presented the subject. So he made a living demonstration.
treasurer of the board.
Well, when I published it, I called that, that's my ESP interpretation.
We have Sophie and Craig and Dave and Belinsky, and I think that would be it. Please, Sophie.
What I did not understand from the various panelists is whether he was a man who believed in an absolute blind truth or in a contextual truth. And I feel we have gotten contradictory information on that important point.
Oh, well, it depends on when you asked him that question.
I think he had a very complex kind of outlook on it. That I think it was sort of Einstein's resolution that sure, there's a lot of relativism, a lot of dependence of things on context. But if you look at it with an appropriate level of abstraction, you can see invariances. And he liked that term, invariance. And he taught us to look for what was invariant in spite of the obvious influence of context and the period of time and the social influence and all that. All of that was valid, but it didn't lead him to the swamps of relativism. Great.
Yeah, I just wanted to add that I found the discussion very interesting too. My connection to Dr. Rappaport comes by way of my teachers, Dr. Schlesinger and Dr. David Shapiro. And what was interesting about my training is that I was in graduate school in the late 80s. And at the new school, we were still reading Rapport, Gill, and Schaefer, which actually made me quite different than other graduate students had moved to the Exner model, which is much more empirically driven. And the part of the training that's missing is a discussion of when a person gives a certain person, what's the psychology behind giving that response? What do the determinants mean? What does it mean psychologically to see shading, to see color, to mix those two things, and then look at it in terms of form? And all that was laid out in ways in Rappaport, Gill, and Schaefer that was not in the other models used, primarily Exner's model now, which is much more, it has its strong points because it's empirically driven. There's no discussion anymore. What does it mean to give a certain response? And that's what I learned under Dr. Schlesinger and took. And also, this gives me great insights, by the way, into some of your teaching style with me. I now know where you got it from. And by the way, I've been using it. I think he does permit me to call him Herb. But, in his public forums, I still refer to him as Dr. Schlesinger.
He's also central in the teachings of Paul Harris, who taught diagnostic
right.
In the 60s, also from Brooklyn College.
Well, let me give you a really how this expressed itself. I started a study here at Riggs. And by the way, when I arrived at Riggs, increasingly the number of fellows coming in are no longer trained in Rappaport, Gill, and Schaefer. And it's Dick Ford who insists, again, on reminding people what responses mean psychologically. And we still have those discussions. But when I arrived here, I started a study on suicide. We were looking at parasuicidal behavior and suicide. And a colleague, Chris Fowler, who's also a member of this group, we were doing the study together, he was trained in Exner's system. And one particularly important response was the color shading response. And in Exner's system, because it was empirically driven, and there wasn't a lot of thought into why one gave a color shading response, what it might mean psychologically, he collapses in the system a response which includes color and shading, versus Rappaport, then built on by Stephen Applebaum, the color shading response where they're blended together. This collapse.
That's Holtzman as well as
Applebaum. And then, So the what we did is we looked at this data, and I told Chris that I thought Exner didn't have this, and Chris is a bright guy. We separated those two responses out and found that it was the true color shading response, which we then called it, became very important determining parasuicidal and suicidal behavior. And this wasn't any special insight of mine. It was going back to my training and looking at rationales for giving responses. and actually that article was published in JAFTA, where we talked about the true color shading response as opposed to the color and shading where both exist as determinants.
Let me add one thing. One of the difficulties with the EXA system is that they rarely publish in referee journals. They're privately distributed reports. And so they are not, they're not adjudicated properly.
On his account, I remember I had a very expensive account. He said he slept through most of his
He did, or his analyst.
Well, he said he slept, so he wouldn't know what it was.
That's the name of the play. I'm not Rappaport.
Book is a book.
Mm-hmm.
That was by David Rappaport, his analyst, written by David Rappaport, our David.
Yeah.
I remember it actually. But he told me that he had this fatherly friend whose name was Rappaport, or whatever David. He used to. The older man would tell him about his patients, which David found fascinating, and he said, "You really should write this down." And the man said, "Well, I've never been able to write." So David volunteered to take down what he was saying and shape it into a book. And so he published several books, but his name does not appear on it.
Peter Schiller's father was a colleague. He was a mythologist, a Hungarian mythologist who came to this country and was at MIT and died in a skiing accident trying to ski down Tuckerman's Ravine. He was buried in an avalanche, but they were very close friends.
Doris, the last.
Listening to the profound effect that Rappaport had on the students, one of the things that I'm struck with in my teaching is that when I mention David Rappaport, and now I've gotten accustomed to saying, do you know who David Rappaport is? No one knows who David Rappaport is. What I want to know is, how did that come to pass? After all, his first students are really leading people in the field. How is it that he evaporated like that?
You asked the same question about who was Gardner Murphy. Have you heard Gardner Murphy?
What is known about his roots in Hungary, after all, politically, Hungary was governed by 40 fascists, and that's one is a political question. Second, what was his relationship to the Hungarian psychoanalytic group, which was quite powerful? So those are two kind of lacunas that I'd be curious about.
All I know is that he often spoke of Wimmer Hermann. Bob and Phil and Herb, Roy, Peter, and Fred for sharing their experiences.